Good Sabbath.
Good Sabbath.
We welcome all of you to worship and our streamers. We hope it's a blessed Sabbath for all. Let's share together in our call to worship from Deuteronomy 6, verses 4 through 9. Hear, O Israel, the Lord is our God. The Lord is one. You shall love the Lord your God with all your heart and with all your soul and with all your might. These words, which I am commanding you today, shall be on your heart. You shall teach them diligently to your sons, and shall talk of them when you sit in your house, and when you walk by the way, and when you lie down, and when you rise up. You shall bind them as a sign on your hand, and they shall be as frontals on your forehead. You shall write them on the doorposts of your house and on your gates. Our morning hymn is number 66, To God Be the Glory. Let's open our Bibles to the back and do our affirmation of faith regarding the church. Our hymnals. Yeah, it's a hymnal. We believe that the Church of God is all believers gathered by the Holy Spirit and joined into one body, of which Christ is the head. We believe that the local church is a community of believers organized in covenant relationship for worship, fellowship, and service, practicing and proclaiming common convictions, while growing in grace and in the knowledge of our Lord and Savior, Jesus Christ. We believe in the priesthood of all believers and practice the autonomy of the local congregation as we seek to work in association with others for more effective witness. Let us pray. Oh, Heavenly Gracious Father, we thank you so much for the Sabbath and the opportunity to come and worship you today. Lord, we thank you and praise you for the week that we've had, the work that we've done, and the chance to get back to school and all the other things we do this time of year. Father, we just thank you for the blessings you've given us and presenting the challenges before us that we've had the opportunity to learn more about you and your grace and your intentions for good for us. Father, we just praise you and thank you, and we thank you most of all for your Son who taught us how to pray. Our Father, who art in heaven, hallowed be thy name. Thy kingdom come, thy will be done, on earth as it is in heaven. Give us this day our daily bread, and forgive us our debts, as we forgive our debtors. And lead us not into temptation, but deliver us from evil. For thine is the kingdom, and the power, and the glory forever. Amen. So I think we're going to install some Sabbath school leaders. Is that the plan?
So for those of you that don't know me, I am Melissa Noel, and we started our new Sabbath school year today with a little bit of a Sabbath school rally. We had some students that were moving up, and we had a little bit of fellowship. We had quite a bit of fun, and I hope you all that were in Sabbath school had a great time. And one of the things we do here during worship is install our Sabbath school teachers. And so, I'm sorry, there's a lot of goofiness going on back there. And so I'm going to call our Sabbath school teachers up. Our pre-K, nursery, kindergarten, first Sabbath school teacher is Eliana Kroniger. Whoever's littlest, she gets. That's you. And then our first and second grade teacher is Abigail Noel. And then our third, fourth, fifth, and sixth grade teacher, and if anybody wants to volunteer to take a couple of those kids, no, I'm just joking, is myself, Melissa Noel. And then our high school teacher is Susie Sanborn. So that's our youth department. And then for our adult classes, we have Lyle Sutton facilitating the blockheads. Well, he said he doesn't want to be the teacher, so he's the facilitator. And Peggy Kroniger is the facilitator for the backside class. Now, the names of our Sabbath school classes go way, way back. I know. So just if you're confused, the blockheads and the backside, and then we have the food for thought class. Now, that one's a little easier to explain because they meet down where we eat. So that's why they're the food for thought. And Pastor Ken is the facilitator and leader for that class. So we are our Sabbath school teachers, leaders, facilitators, and we invite you all to come and join a class if you haven't already done so. It's important to come to Sabbath school. Some people think, oh, it's just one more thing to do on a Sabbath morning. But that's where we really can dig into the Word of God and find out what it means and find out what it God wants for us when we read that meaning. So it's important. And Pastor, you are going to pray for us?
Yes. And remember, teachers are only as good as their pupils. So let's all stand as we support our teachers this year. Father, we do thank you that we have the opportunity to serve you in your word, to know, Father, that you speak to us in your word and you call others to facilitate and to be teachers of the Sabbath school. A place, Father, where we can hold and glorify you. A place, Father, where we can come to know you better because we learn and know your word. And so this Sabbath morning, each of us once more say that we're going to study, show ourselves approved unto you, workmen that need not to be ashamed, rightly dividing the word of truth. And this we pray in the name of Jesus. Amen.
My husband asked me if I was still talking. So my moment is just a reminder that we changed up fellowship meal a little bit. This Sabbath we are having fellowship meal. The Christian Ed Committee is sponsoring fellowship meal, so make sure you stay after. We're going to play a few games if you're there to play a few games after we eat, of course. We're not going to play with our food. Well, actually, we are going to play with food, but it's after we eat. So come on down and enjoy a meal with us. And then also next month for October, we do not have a class, a group of people, a committee that has sponsored fellowship meal yet. So as of this moment, there is not an official fellowship meal, just so you can plan. But it is association, so you'll be able to eat at association when you come there. So.
And I would continue the moment in two ways. Again, if I could have a couple young ladies come and help me. We're going to pass out cards again. We say we do this 2 weeks in a row. If you do not receive the Sabbath recorder, the general conference, here's some cards. I don't know who else is coming out with you. Okay. All right. The Sabbath recorder is the general conference magazine. It comes out 11 times a year. If you have desire to receive it in your home, please put your address down. Hopefully do it in pen. A pencil fades a little bit, especially when I put it in places that sweat. Okay? So, but we did have three last week that wanted to receive the Sabbath recorder in their home. If you do not receive it, one of the things we're doing this year is we're attempting to say, this is what General Conference is all about. This is one way of learning. So fill it out, put it in the offering plate when the offering plate comes by, and then we'll take it and we'll send it to Jeremiah Owen, and he will make sure that it gets already in. The last three have already gone to him, and he has said, I've sent them on. So if you do not receive, once you hear that from me, if you do not receive, let's say by next month, your Sabbath recorder, please let me know, because I like to hold Jeremiah accountable. Okay, that's number one. Number two is, thank you, Amber, for being... Oh, wait a minute, Amber, get a microphone. Oh, I'm glad you're up here, Amber. Now, Amber, I have a question for you. What's happening on September the 26th, Wednesday?
See you at the poll. So we're praying at the flagpole at Alfred Almond Central School.
All right, and who's invited to be there?
Anyone.
You mean these people out there could be there?
Yes.
What time?
I don't know. 7:30.
Amber planned this all out. That's why. 7:30, you will be there, Amber, right?
Yep.
Okay, 7:30, you will be there. And your last to 8 o'clock is an opportunity for people to pray. And then I heard that Morgan went already and talked to Mr. Calkins. And guess what's happening the next day on the campus at the Alfred Almond Central School? Can you guess?
A Bible study.
A Bible club, a Bible study is happening. Mr. Reck, the chemistry teacher, has said yes to being there. Mr. Calkins has put his okay on it. They'll be studying C.S. Lewis, and they, as youth, are going to be praying with one another. And that, again, is at what time?
7:30.
And it'll last so that they can get to class by 8:15. So keep that in prayer already. Both see you at the pool and the Bible club. Thank you very much. The last moment that I have is something special is happening on Sunday evening at 6 o'clock at the Wellsville Bible Church. A man by the name of Pastor Lonnie Riley from Lynch, Kentucky, will be talking. Lynch is what we don't longer use the word revival because that's not what we want. We want communities transformed for Jesus. Lynch was one of those communities about 15 years ago that had the highest drug rate in the state of Kentucky. Today, they have no drug rate, and they didn't kick people out. They turned their community over to the Lord Christ. And we used to call it revival happened, but real transformation happened. And so Pastor Lonnie will be talking about how this happened. And so I invite you to be 6 o'clock over at the Wellsville Bible Church to be able to hear the story of Lynch, Kentucky. They are part of ECHA, a part of Mission Genesee Valley, and so together we serve in the kingdom of God.
Our new song today is When I Survey the Wondrous Cross, and it's a favorite of Pastor Ken, so happy birthday, darling. It's written by Isaac Watts, and when teenager Isaac Watts complained to his father about the monotonous way Christians in England sang the Old Testament Psalms, his father, a leading deacon, snapped back, "All right, young man, you give us something better." To Isaac Watts, the singing of God's praise was the form of worship nearest to heaven, and he went on to argue, "Its performance among us is the worst on earth." Young Isaac accepted his father's challenge and eventually wrote a total of more than 600 hymns, earning him the title the Father of English Hymnody. Even as a child, Isaac had shown a passion for poetry, rhyming, and such mundane things as everyday conversation. His serious-minded father, after several warnings, decided to spank the rhyming nonsense out of his son. But the tearful Isaac helplessly replied, "Oh, Father, do some pity take, and I will no more verses make." However, choirs, congregations, and individual Christians rejoice to this day that the young lad did not keep his impromptu promise. If he had, none of us would have the thrill of singing such all-time favorites as "O God, Our Help in Ages Past," "Am I a Soldier of the Cross," or "Joy to the World." As a child, Isaac Watts was sickly and unattractive, yet even by today's standards, he was clever beyond years. He began the study of Latin at the age of 4 and added Greek when he was 9, French at 11, and Hebrew at 13. At 15, the young poet turned his talents to the service of the church, and the great career in hymn writing began. In his hymns, Isaac Watts takes the word of God, of which he must have been a diligent student, and distills it so that all is wisdom, beauty, and comfort are set before us with plainness and power. No wonder, then, that C.H. Spurgeon's grandfather, himself a great preacher, and in the line of the Puritans, would have nothing else but the hymns of Isaac Watts sung in his services. Isaac Watts's greatest composition must surely be When I Survey the Wondrous Cross. It has been called the very best hymn in the English language, and in it, Watts, using only 16 lines, paints a soul-stirring picture of the Savior's death on the cross, coupled with the wholehearted response of the believer to such amazing love. How blessed to reflect on the finished work of Christ Jesus, as summed up in those lines, "See from his head, his hands, his feet, sorrow and love flow mingled down. Did e'er such love and sorrow meet, or thorns compose so rich a crown?" And how enriching to be able to voice a reconsecration to the Lord's service in the words, "Were the whole realm of nature mine, that were an offering far too small, love so amazing, so divine, demands my soul, my life, my all." Please sing When I Survey the Wondrous Cross. There's no smaller people out there? No, it's not balloons. All my littlest people left. I might have to have... No, I don't know if these will fit. I know that's the problem. You need small. Well, good Sabbath. Good Sabbath. So, this week was the start of school. And I know everybody's always a little nervous. I always feel like I'm going to throw up a little when I get ready to go back to work. And But for me, it started out really well. I was very excited how my first few days went. So I hope your days went well. Did they go well?
My stomach twisted and turned on the first day.
Oh, okay, how about you?
I wasn't scared at all. I have awesome class.
You got an awesome class? Okay, good. Well, I was thinking about school, and sometimes school can be hard. Sometimes people can be mean. Sometimes we can be mean when we're at school. Sometimes just in the world, things get hard. Well, in the Bible, in the book of Ephesians, which Pastor Ken will probably be preaching on this in a few weeks, it talks about how to be strong in the Lord and in the strength of his might. And in order to be strong, a lot of times you need to fight. But God doesn't tell us to fight. He says to put on the full armor of God. Now, armor is protection. It's not for fighting. It's for protecting. So, you gonna do it, Aaron? Okay. So God says in Ephesians that you have to gird yourself with truth. So put the belt on. You can stand up if you want to. So when we're at school, it's important. Well, you got it kind of crookedy, but that's okay. You can handle it. It's going to be, there you go. To put on the truth. So you're not, okay. Stick it through. There you go. And it's important when you're at school or even at home or here to tell the truth. Because then people can trust you. People can trust you. And then it tells us to put on the breastplate. And again, I don't know if this is going to fit you or not. But
this is too big for me.
There we go. Put on the breastplate of righteousness. That means we need to try and do things the right way. We need to try and do things the right way. And not try to take shortcuts. Then it says to shod yourself in the gospel of peace. So the gospel of peace, we need to share the love of Jesus and the peace that Jesus brings. So we need to watch our anger and our attitudes when we're at school or at home. And we need to practice being peaceful. And then we need our shield of faith. To stop the devil's arrows. So when people are being mean to us or trying to tell lies about us, we have that shield of faith. That means we have to believe that God is there with us through all those hard times. Then we have to put on the helmet of salvation. The helmet of salvation. Now, I know, it's your protection. Now, your salvation is believing in Jesus Christ. Because if we don't have Jesus in our hearts, then we don't have that salvation to help us through the hard times. Now, a sword. Now, you would think that a sword, you need a sword to kill things, right? Well, guess what God's sword is? The Bible. Now, wait a minute. We're supposed to kill things with the Bible? No. We're supposed to use the Bible to help teach other people about the love and the joy and the peace of God. The Bible's words are powerful. And so it's important for us to be reading our Bibles and knowing those words so that we can teach others about God. And then the last thing he says is we need to pray. Don't open it. We need to pray. Not just once in a while, but all the time. We need to pray. So when God is telling us to put on the full armor, yes, he wants us to be ready to fight, but we have to fight with his word, with the scripture. And then we have to make sure that we're telling the truth, we're doing things the right way, we're being peaceful and sharing Jesus' love, that we make sure that we really believe to stop those arrows, that we have Jesus in our hearts, and that we know his word. Let's pray. Dear Father, we just thank you and praise you that you've given us this armor to put on, to help us to fight against the meanness of this world, of the devil's realm. We just thank you and praise you, Father, for the good start of the school year. And we just ask, Father, that you help us remember to use your word to share the love and the peace of Jesus. I pray all this in your name. Amen. Would you take everything off and put them back in the book, please? Yep, put them right in there. Don't forget your pokey one. Thank you, Ryan.
God has richly blessed us. Now if our ushers would call upon us and we return our blessings to God.
us with this opportunity of worship. We thank you for everything that you have given to us, and we ask that you would use this little bit that we're giving back to help other people feel your blessing. In Jesus' name, amen.
Now is our opportunity to be a community at prayer. So let's start out by recognizing birthdays and anniversaries. Do we have any birthdays this coming week? We do. Pastor Ken, when is your birthday? Let's sing happy birthday to Pastor Ken. Happy birthday to you. Happy birthday to you. Happy birthday, dear Ken. Happy birthday to you. Just wanted to feel extra special, that's all. Any other birthdays this coming week? Oh, you're just not standing up because we're not going to sing to you. Yeah, you're next week, I know. Are there any anniversaries this coming week? Okay. Let's pray for a conference congregation, the Philadelphia SDB Church in Philadelphia, PA, Pastor Kenroy Cruikshank and wife Maureen, serving internationally. I think we're all acquainted with Brian Baruch Vaniska, who's in the Jerusalem Center for Bible Translations. Our member is Eugene Ormsby, lives in Wellsville. Military Douglas Preston, and leaders across the world, Pastor Ian Ingo and John Goodwin in Auckland, New Zealand. Okay, that's good.
We continue by having our young ladies come back up again to carry the mic to you so that your requests and your praises can be shared. And perhaps you had an opportunity to share your faith and would ask you to do that. I would make a request for you. There was an anniversary, but the person is, they aren't here. The Boyds were here earlier for Sabbath school today, both Tyler and Rochelle. And, of course, they brought the three Tyler sisters with them and Rochelle's two brothers. Their anniversary is actually today, a year ago. And so keep them in your prayers. But most of all, keep them in the prayers for the adoption. They are attempting to adopt Elric and Elizabeth. So please keep that in prayer. The adoption is going smoothly at this point, but they're still in that bureaucratic waiting. So keep that in your prayers. Would there be other concerns, other praises, or even an opportunity you had to witness?
I'm going to go first. Again, I said it's children's message that school started very well for me, and I think Heather also stated that she had a good start. How about yours, Susie? Pretty good? Good. So I ask that you continue to pray for us as teachers, but two of my students are homeless. So I just ask that you pray for a couple of my students. And when you think of homeless, a lot of times with pictures of people sitting on a street somewhere, they are in hotel rooms and those kind of things, but they don't have a permanent place to live. So just keep them in your prayers and other students that are also in the same situation. It just makes school that much harder for them.
Hi, this is Amanda Snyder again. And I just wanted to let you know I had my staples removed and my two drains removed. I see the doctor in 3 weeks, but in the meantime, I can raise my hands to my chin and no wingy dingy. No wingy dingy with my arms. Wingy dingy. There we go.
We went all the way through.
Many of you will remember Naomi. Naomi, her sister Kylie, and brother Michael have been moved into their Aunt Kylie's house. It's a much more stable, safe environment for them.
Our technician decided, and we'll explain, that we tried the same mic that we had tried last week. And as you can see, results were better. We waited until this portion of the worship service before we started with the noise. We think that there might be a break in one of the lines. And so we'll be trying to use this mic this morning, this afternoon, and we'll keep in our prayers together. So together then, let's look to the Lord in prayer. How beautiful it is, Father, for us to come together as a people to bring you our worship and to know that you're a God who receives it because of Calvary. Father, we've heard today of some things that we've been praying for a long time. And it is good to see that your answer comes even as we wait. Waiting is a hard thing, Father, for us as human beings. But of course you know that because Jesus came and lived amongst us. We rejoice in the fact that you're the one who has taught doctors and nurses the specialty of being there in terms of medical needs, medical provision, medical advice. And we pray for those in that field that they will, Father, be able to give you praise and honor and glory and receive all their knowledge from your hand. We think this morning, Father, of our sister church there in Philadelphia. We think of Kenroy and his wife. We think, Father, of their building that they are worshiping in, and of the strength you have given them to continue to pay off their mortgage and their debt. And yet, Father, we also know that you are bringing others into the kingdom because of the work and their worship. Continue that process, Father, we would pray. We pray this morning for Baruch and his family there in Israel, and ask, Father, for a special touch of grace towards his translation work. That as he teaches others how to translate the Old Testament, that the fact that your son is Messiah might show forth even in the work that they go back home to do for their own home translations of what we call the Old Testament. We thank you for Eugene, Father. We thank you, Father, for the blessings that he has in Wellsville. But also help him to remember that he is a part of our congregation. This morning, Father, we would pray for those that we know in the military. We would pray, Father, for this young man, and we would ask, Father, for safety and protection. We know, Father, that with service of people like him and like others that we know, that we enjoy the freedom that we have today to worship you according to the conscience and the leadership of your Holy Spirit and the righteousness of your word. And we pray for our brothers in Auckland. Our prayer, Father, for them is that they would be able to give leadership to those that are there. The kind of leadership that says that they are stable and that they are willing to do that which is necessary to evangelize that portion of the world in which they live. You provide grace for us to move on. And with our sister's request this morning, we think of the blessings that we have received from your hand, the shelters that we have, the homes that are ours. We pray for these young people and their families, that they too would have such blessing. I ask a special touch of your grace today, Father, upon the summit. I ask, Father, that you also will be with those who loved ones have passed away this week, that you'll walk alongside of them as the comforter through the Holy Spirit. Now, Father, for just a moment, we would speak to you of our special needs, both here physically and as our streamers pray also virtually. That special need that they have and we have might be to honor and glorify you, but Father, we have to say that that need is so far down in us, we don't want to talk about it. Take it out of us by the work of the Spirit now. In the name of Jesus. And unto you be glory and honor and praise. In the name of our Lord Jesus. Amen.
Our scripture is from Psalm chapter 119, verses 98 to 100. Your commandments make me wiser than my enemies, for they are ever mine. I have more insight than all my teachers, for your testimonies are my meditation. I understand more than the aged, because I have observed your precepts.
Gary, Pat, Adele, others that are on streaming, forgive me for not inviting you also into the Sabbath Recorder. If you send me your address by the email, I will make sure if you don't get it, you desire it, that you have it. Today is Sabbath School Rally Day. It seems a year ago that we had this. Because it was a year ago. What's its purpose? Well, it reminds us that summer is over. In fact, several of the churches around here are having Back to Church Sunday tomorrow. We have Sabbath School Rally Day to remind us that summer's over. It reminds us that it's supposed to promote Sabbath School and to say this is a place where you can study the Word of God. You can go forward with that. But I think the most important part of Sabbath School Rally Day is once more to say, let's exalt the Scriptures. Let's exalt the Word of God. Let's exalt the Bible. Let's say the Bible is the most important thing that we have of God's communication to us directly. It belongs to us, and it is ours. And the purpose of Sabbath School Rally Day is to say, we believe the Word of God. We believe the Scriptures. Now, I want to do a little Bible trivia with you today. What I want you to do is I'm going to ask a question, and if you know the answer, I want you to raise your hand. Now, I'm not going to call on anybody, because if I call on somebody and you're wrong, I don't want you to feel bad. And if I call on you and you're right, I don't want you going around, nah, 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 I know the answer. And I know also our streamers, where they are, they can raise their hand, okay? So here's the very first question. What chapter of the Bible is the largest in the book of Psalms? If you know the answer, raise your hand. And the answer is Psalm 119. Now you can pat yourself on the back if you got it right. If you got it wrong, go, I'll get the next one. Because there are a total of four, and we're on the second one. Are you ready? What chapter in the Bible has the most verses? You know the answer to that? Raise your hand. If you said Psalm 119, you're exactly right. It has 176 verses. All right. What in the English Bible is the largest chapter in the book of the entire Bible? If you know the answer, raise your hand. The answer is Psalm 119. And if you got it right, you're absolutely correct. Now the last one. What chapter in the Bible contains the entire Hebrew alphabet in sections? And what we know is that in the Hebrew, the major thought or the major verse begins with that letter. If you know the answer, raise your hand. If you said Psalm 119, you're exactly correct. We're looking this morning at what is in the mem section. That's one of those Hebrew words, Hebrew letters. We're looking at that this morning. Now, there are some, we've said it over and over again, there are some numbers in the Bible that appear over and over. 47, 3. And in this scripture that we're looking at this morning, we're going to look together at three people groups. Then we're going to talk about three views of looking at the Word of God. And then we're going to talk about three results that we want. And finally, we're going to talk about three ways we get those results. So there's patterns here this morning. First, 119, and now the Word. Three. So our text this morning tells us about three different people groups. The first people group that it talks about is enemies. Of course, nobody here has enemies, right? You may have people that oppose you, but you wouldn't call them enemies. And yet, the scripture is telling us here that the writer of the Psalms, who I believe in this particular psalm was David, David is saying, I have enemies, and God has given me a way to deal with them. And we'll talk about that in a moment. The second thing that we have is teachers. Teachers. Now, teachers are good people. Not all teachers teach, but not all. But who is a teacher? A teacher is one who knows more than what you know and is willing to share with you what they know in a way that you'll know what they know. That's a teacher. And then we have the aged. The aged. Now, that varies, right? If you're 4 years old, a teenager is old. No. If you're 10 years old, somebody in their 20s is old. Yep. If you're in the 20s, if you're 40 or 50, you're old. And if you're in the 50, 60 range, when you're in the 80s and 90s, you're old. And if you're 90 range, those 100 people, those centenarians, they're old. So old varies, but David puts it nice. Aged. 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 Now, some of you have drawn one of those wonderful Venn diagrams before, right? You take a circle, and you put another circle over it. In this circle, we're going to put teacher, and in this circle, we're going to put agent. Which means agent and teacher are different from each other. But some agents are also teachers. And then down at the bottom, we're going to put another circle. And that circle says, some teachers are enemies. And some aged are enemies. And some aged teachers are enemies. But not all. But that's the group of people and the people groups that are being talked about in this particular scripture. Now we're going to view for us, take several views of the Word of God. All of these are the Word of God. And they fall into, if you'll take a look at it, they fall into what? Commandments, testimonies, and precepts. Commandments, testimonies, and precepts. Now we know what commandments are. Commandments are, we read it in God's Word, and if it says it, we, what? Do it. Because the commandment is there for us to do. We know about Exodus 20, right? Exodus 20 are the Ten Commandments. We do it. We don't kill. We don't steal. We don't commit adultery. We honor our father and mother. Then we go to the New Testament, and we have Jesus telling us this. He says the two greatest commandments are love God with all your heart, mind, soul, and some would say strength. That's the commandment. And then the second one is like this. What are you supposed to do? Love your neighbor as yourself. That's what the text says for us to do. That's a command, and so we do it. How about this one? As you go into all the world, make disciples of every nation, baptizing them in the name of the Father and the Son and the Holy Spirit, teaching them to observe all that I have commanded you, and lo, I am with you always, even to the end of the age. Well, that's a command. So we do it. But then there's something called testimony. Testimony means I have the book of Psalms, and I go all the way back to Abraham, and we have Abraham being called by God out of the Ur of the Chaldees, and Abraham was told, I'm going to make your descendants like the stars of the heaven, like the sands of the seas. And the scripture says, Abram believed God, and it was counted unto him for righteousness, and it's written down in scripture, and therefore it becomes a testimony. God brought Israel out of the land of Egypt, out of the house of bondage. God brought them to the Red Sea. And Moses says, stand back and see what the Lord will do. And the Red Sea opens. That's a testimony. Today we have the testimony that goes on beyond Psalms. It is the testimony of the apostles and the prophets of this. But it's also our own testimony. So I got a question for you again to raise your hand. No, it's not Psalm 119. What I want you to do is this. If God has ever answered a prayer for you, raise your hand. You have just given a testimony, and that's what it means in Scripture. Scripture is a witness that God has done something for his people. Okay? Let's make that little diagram again. We have command. We have testimony. And we have a place that it overlaps. So some testimonies are commands and some commands are testimonies. But look at the next one. We're going to draw a circle and we're going to put precepts there. Those are principles that we are called to live by. I beseech you, therefore, brethren, by the mercies of God, that you present your body a living sacrifice, holy, acceptable unto God, which is your reasonable service of worship, and be not conformed to this world, but be transformed by the renewing of your mind. That is a principle to live by. And the scripture throughout gives us principles to live by. How we are going to walk under the guidance of the Holy Spirit. Three views of scripture here. Three different kinds of people groups. Three views of scripture: command, testimony, precept. Now we have three results. And here are the results that are given. I want to be wiser than my enemies. I want to be wiser than the ones who oppose me. Yes? Yes, I think we all want that. If somebody opposes us, we want to be wiser than the one who opposes us. Well, Scripture tells us how to do it, right? We go over to the New Testament, and Jesus said, you got enemies? What are you supposed to do with them? Love them. And we want to say, are you kidding, Jesus? Love them. And in so doing, you will be wiser than your enemy. Or how about this? If your enemy hunger, feed him, for in so doing, you will heap coals of fire upon their head. Now, I don't know whether that was Paul being righteous or nasty. Because you see, what happens was when an enemy came against your city, you had a big bucket full of hot coals. And as they got closer to your gate, you dumped it on them. And you heard the screaming and the yelling and the running away from your gate. That's the nasty part. Paul is saying the enemy cannot get to you if you take care of the enemy. So if they hunger, feed them. Whether it be physically or spiritually. Wiser than the enemy. And more insight than your teachers. Anybody have a teacher? Anybody want to have more insight than their teacher? Yes. I used to get so aggravated at my teacher teaching poetry. Because they would say, does anybody know what this poem is about? And I would raise my hand and say, yeah, this poem's about this. And then they would go, let me tell you what it's really about. And you go, wait a minute. Wait a minute. What's going on here? Well, the principle is this. You can have more insight into what the teacher is teaching than the teacher. That's okay. Did you know it is quite possible that while the pastor is preaching, that the Holy Spirit might be preaching you a different kind of message? A good one, but a takeoff, a different one, giving you insight into the same scripture that is being preached on. And you know what? That's okay if it's from the Holy Spirit. That's okay if I'm not going, well, I don't like what he's saying, therefore I'm going to make up my own sermon. That's okay. Because you're receiving insight from the teacher. My little brother helped me change oil. We did this when I was in Maryland. And we swore that we will never do that again. couldn't get the filter off. We tried every way. Finally, it was the screwdriver through the filter with the hole, and we wrenched it off that way. But he was my teacher, and I had insight. Jiffy Lube. But you see, that's the point. The teacher is doing their job if the student receives, or the one who is the learner receives, insight. Look at the third thing. The third thing the scripture teaches is that there is age, but there is something called understanding. Understanding more than the aged? Yes. Understanding. Because you take what the age has said. Did you know that often what a person older than ourselves says goes in one ear and out the other? Amen? Mm-hmm. Yeah, it does. But if we take what their experience is, and they survive longer than us, and they have street knowledge, and they have work knowledge, and they have experience that way, and we take what they say, we can have understanding, and often understanding more than what was presented to us in the first place. So, what do we have? We have those three elements of results from the Word of God. How then do we get it? Well, the first way we get it is with our enemies. The Bible says, absorb it. Take it in. Make it part of you. Absorb it. How do you memorize Scripture? I'm going to give you a simple method. Read it over and over and over again. Absorb it. I want to tell you about a man by the name of Howard Hendricks, who used to be professor of Christian education down at Dallas Theological Seminary. When I heard him speak, he said he talked about his students as one of the illustration who would be walking down the hall on a test day. And Dr. Hendricks would go to shake his hand. And the student would go, "Don't touch me, Prof, I'll leak." Because he had learned everything he could and he didn't want to lose anything before he went into the test. That's how much we should know the Word of God, and we should be able to say, "They are mine." Because I think in this text, "they" refers to the methodology, not to the fact of the wisdom or the enemy being his. They are mine. The second thing is to meditate. Meditate. I want to have insight. I meditate upon God's Word. Blessed the man that walks not in the counsel of the ungodly, nor standeth in the way of sinners, nor sitteth in the seat of the scornful, but in his law doth he meditate day and night. Now, every once in a while, I'm taken aback by the fact that I grew up in a city. The city doesn't have cows walking around. Yes, it doesn't. Well, I found out this week at Bible study again, when we crossed over this passage that said that the calves leap for joy. I said, "Are you kidding?" But I had two ladies in the Bible study that started, yeah, I know what that is, yeah, that's fantastic. Well, it happened also here with Casey Green. Casey came up and told us something that cows do. And by the way, I learned giraffes do the same thing. They chew their cud. They eat the grass or whatever the first time, and then they regurgitate it and eat it again. Well, guess what? That's a perfect picture of meditation. Eat it, take it in, regurgitate it, and eat it again. And eat it again. And eat it again. And constantly be chewing like the cow out in the pasture. That's the second part of how we get insight. Now, the third part, that part that says we're going to know more than the agent, how do we get that? We have understanding. Those three ways, how do we get that understanding? By being obedient. Obedient. If we are obedient, then we will do what God wants us to do. And that will give us understanding more than the agent. Three people groups. As we look at our scripture, three views of scripture and God's word. Three results. Three ways for us as a believer to exalt the word of God. There's an old preacher story that goes something like this. There was a man who was a collector of books, old books, ancient books, etc. And he happened to bump into a friend of his on the street. And his friend was telling him about this old book that he just threw away. What kind of book was it? Oh, it was one of those old Bibles. You know, it was one that, and I looked it up, it was one that was worked on by somebody by the name of Guten. You did what? Guten, that's what it says. Was it possible that that man had a first edition Gutenberg, which would have been the first publication of the German Bible on a printing press and the work of the printing press throughout Europe? He had a Bible in his hand, but he did not value it. The purpose of Sabbath School Rally Day is this. That we once again value the Word of God. That we once again value the Bible. Let's pray. Father, we thank you for the love that you give us, the fact that you wanted to communicate with us, and so you gave us your Word. Thank you for that blessing, but also thank you for that responsibility. The responsibility that comes to us, Father, of absorbing it. The responsibility that comes of meditating in it. The responsibility that comes of obeying it. And this we pray in the name of Jesus. Amen. Thank you. And now may the love of God the Father, the grace of the Lord Jesus Christ, and the fellowship of the Holy Spirit be with each of us from this Sabbath into eternity.